So shall we start? So good afternoon friends, namaskar, और आप सबका लाइब्रेरी प्रोफेशनल एसोसिएशन के वेबिनार सीरीज में स्वागत है. दिस इज आवर 17th वेबिनार ऑफ दिस सीरीज एंड आई एम वेरी हैप्पी टू अनाउंस एंड वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर दिस 17th वेबिनार ऑफ द लाइब्रेरी प्रोफेशनल एसोसिएशन. I just give a bit of introduction of the Library Professional Association. Basically, this association is a non-for-profit professional body founded for scientific, literary, and educational purposes. Hello, I'm audible to everyone. Hello. Okay. Yeah, I just going to start now.
You are very much audible, lecturer Anandji. You are very much audible.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So now I start. So I'm just giving the introduction of the Library Professional Association. So this association is a non-for-profit professional body founded for the scientific, literary, and educational purposes and dedicated to the creation, organization, dissemination, and applications of the knowledge concerning information and its transfer. An auxiliary purpose of the association is to provide its members a variety of channels of communication within and outside the profession, including meetings and publications, with the service to help them in their professional development and advancement. This association is a group of people who work in the different organizations and come together to work for the profession and professional development. So that is the purpose of Library Professional Association. I request all the professional, you come forward, join LPA and do the work together. That is our motto. So now, today our webinar today is the basically moderator of this webinar is Madam Lalita Dhir from Chandigarh, and she is also very dedicated professional and dedicated manpower for our professional body or Library Professional Association. So I request Lalita ji to take over this conference further. Lalita ji.
Thank you, Mr. Anand, for your kind words, and good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Library Professional Association of India, myself, Lalita Dhir, Regional Coordinator of Chandigarh, welcome my esteemed speaker, host, co-host, and most valuable participants. Their participation is encouraging for us to LPA and the theme of today's webinar. Thank you. Malviya ji.
Hello. Good afternoon to everyone. I, Dr. Ramanand Malviya, President, Library Professional Association, welcome you all on this online webinar on quality assurance in higher education in India, is organized by Library Professionals Association, New Delhi. The speaker of today's webinar is Dr. Jivesh Bansal, University Librarian, Punjab University, Chandigarh. The moderator of this webinar is Mrs. Lalita Dhir, Library Professional Association Coordinator, Regional Chandigarh. The topic is very important for the library professionals, teachers, researchers, students, academic institutions, etc. The higher education in India has evolved very nearly 70 years in independent India, and various measures have been taken at the government level to address the issues of quality and access to higher education. The internal quality assurance system of higher education institutions are self-regulated. Responsibility of higher education institutions aimed at continuous improvement of quality and achieving academic excellence. The institution has an internal quality assurance cell and adopt a participatory approach in the managing its provisions. Quality improvement in education system is mainly related to teaching, evaluation, Hello. Techniques, resulting and placement of institution. National Assessment and Accreditation Council, NAAC, formed under the aegis of University Grant Commission, UGC, has implemented new methodology of evaluation of educational institutions in India. The Quality Assurance Higher Education Institutions, UGC, AICT, NAAC, NBA, and QA. The new dimensions of quality measures as proposed by the NAAC involve continuous process of assignment, assessment, and higher education institutions. The stakeholders in the higher education pledge a vital role in the assessment process of the institution. Several governmental bodies like University Grant Commission, National Assessment of Accreditation Council, established as the autonomous body with the objective of assessment of higher education institution in the country, assess the accreditability. Higher education institution by studying and analyzing various parameters toward the quality measures. There are 216 assessment indicators on which the AGEM assessment of the higher education institutions is made. In addition, the best and innovative practices by the institution are also taken into account of the measuring quality transformation of institution. The outcome of the assessment is final institutional grading conferred to the institution. UGC and NAAC have played a vital role in streaming the quality higher education institutions. The process has changed the mindset of the stakeholder towards quality and its sustenance and has involved them to contribute for the achievement. The university should become a socially conscious and the meaningful enterprise. The repositories of the intellectual wealth were often looked upon to take a leadership role within the society, and that students should be exposed to social learning, community and team building skills, civic education, and awareness of social responsibilities. Accreditation for higher education is overseen by autonomous institutions established by University Grant Commissions or AICT, DEC, ICAR, BCI, NAAC, NCTE, RCI, MCI, PCI, INC, DCI, CCH, CCIM, and VCI, etc. These national quality assurance agencies were originally conceived to serve the national interest. By the large, their outcomes are designed to promote quality enhancement. Library Professional Association welcomes Dr. Jivesh Bansal for accepting our request and sparing his valuable time. This webinar has drawn very wide attention and a overwhelming response, both in the terms of participation and selection of the subject. Its current needs and importance for the teachers, researchers, library professionals, and academic institutions. Now I request Mrs. Lalita Dhir, Regional Coordinator, Library Professional Association, New Delhi, to proceed. Over to Mrs. Lalita Dhir.
Thank you, sir. Once again, heartiest congratulations for participating, everyone. Dr. Jivesh Bansal is University Librarian of Punjab University, Chandigarh. He has more than 21 years experience as a professional, including 19 years vast experience at Central Library of Punjab University. He was awarded PhD degree for his doctoral research on information seeking behavior in electronic environment. And you all know that these days we have to depend on the electronic resources, and the topic will be very relevant for this webinar. And he has published more than 25 papers in national and international journals. He has attended a number of workshops, national, international, in abroad or in India. He has many more achievements in his credit. So with this, I hand over the mic to Dr. Jivesh Bansal to enlighten us with his thoughts, and we will definitely improve ourselves in this era. Thank you, and welcome to Dr. Jivesh Bansal. Please, sir.
Thank you, Madam Lalita Ji, and Dr. R. N. Malviya, Dr. Anand Ejha, Dr. Silek Chand, and many other reputed personality on the dais, attendees. First of all, I would like to thank Library Professional Association to provide me a chance to interact with such a large audience that I can share my views on this very relevant topic of today, that is quality assurance in higher education in India. So, my screen is visible to all?
Yes, sir, very much, sir. Yes, sir, yes, sir. You just do the full screen, sir. Yes, sir. So, it's fine, perfectly fine. Yeah, I request all the participants and co-host, apart from the speaker, everyone should mute your audio and video for the.
This is just kind of netiquette of online learning, of online system, that because recently we have organized one seminar, that you should, in this online environment, you should have some etiquette, that net level etiquette, that when one speaker is speaking, then all others should be on the mute.
Thank you very much, Dr. Saab. Please go ahead.
So, we generally talk about quality in our life. What is quality? We generally say that this thing is of good quality, this thing is of bad quality. This is a good college, this is not a reputed college, these things measures the quality standard of anything, any higher education institution. What is the meaning of quality? Quality is something of very, quality assurance, something of very high quality. Assurance means commitment. What is the commitment of the government of India towards quality of higher education? This is the theme of my talk today. So, as we all know that we have a very massive, very diverse, very large higher education system. In India, we have more than 1,000 universities, we have more than 40,000 colleges. We have our private universities, we have deemed universities, we have central universities. And if we will see what is our gross enrollment ratio, that is 26, that was 26.3 in 2018-19, and it is now touching to 30% in 2020. So with such a large, such a massive information system, where we are lacking that our, generally, if we see that कई बार जब हम कुछ एडवर्टाइजमेंट्स वगैरह भी देखते हैं कि यूपी में कुछ पीएनस की पोस्टों ने निकली और वहां पे पीएचडी कैंडिडेट्स ने अप्लाई किया, कुछ एमए के किए हुए स्टूडेंट्स ने अप्लाई किया, सो ये क्या है? दिस शोज द क्वालिटी ऑफ आवर हायर एजुकेशन सिस्टम, दैट आवर हायर एजुकेशन सिस्टम ऑफ इज प्रोवाइडिंग हायर एजुकेशन बट इट इज नॉट ए क्वालिटी हायर एजुकेशन. So in this, we will cover, what is the concept of quality assurance, what is accreditation, what is ranking, what is quality in journal publications, and other issues of quality assurance. Quality assurance, if we will talk about, is an integrated approach covering all the processes in higher education institution, which supports improvements in these processes. Quality assurance is like a total quality management, approach that covers all the processes from teaching learning, from research, from perception, all round of development, which improvement in all these processes so that we can show that the quality of our education is going high and high with the passage of time. Every institution needs an action plan to integrate all its activities for cost effectiveness and competitive advantage. We all know that there is an age of competitive advantage. We are now living in a global world. We are now, you can also assume from this COVID-19 situation, one virus which started from the Wuhan and how it spread within 4 to 5 months into the all the world. We are living in a very globalized world. So we can't stop. Despite our all efforts, we can't stop. Now it has reached to every nook and corner of our country, of our globe. So what it shows, we are living in a very global world. After living in such in a global world, how we can be regional, how we can be only national, until and unless we will not improve ourselves, we will lag behind into the system. So this just I am sharing one. While the country is on the way to massification of higher education, important questions on the quality of institution and the employment of graduates still exist. This is a statement by United States based think tank, the Brookings Institution. So these are the various international bodies which study about the higher education system and say that the quality of higher education system in India is not up to the mark. So there are two things. One thing is affiliation and another thing is accreditation. You all know about what is affiliation. Until and unless an institute is not affiliated to an university or university is not affiliated to UGC, we will say that this is a fake institution. This is first parameter of quality. Accreditation is just a step ahead of this affiliation. What is this accreditation? Accreditation is quality assurance in higher education institutions and programs. From 1956, we have UGC. We have other professional bodies like AICT, Dr. Malibaj also talking about. We have various professional bodies like DCIE, MCIE, which provides affiliation to different institutes, etc. But after, just a minute. But these are just affiliating bodies. No doubt, they send the inspection team to the affiliating when they have give affiliation to an institute. But accreditation is just a step ahead than this. This is a high level quality measure. Accreditation of educational institution basically was started very early in 1880s in the US. National standards of accreditation were not officially established until the early 20th century. How this process of, if you will talk about what is the background of this accreditation, basically when the massification of this higher education started in the US and how this massification started, this is a history that after the World War II, the veterans of this World War were supported with financial assistance to pursue their higher education. There was a large number of these veterans because that was a World War. There was a huge demand of higher education in the US. And when the demand arose, so higher education started appearing overnight in the US. Day by day, 1 month, 2 months, a new college, a new university that started coming out in the US. And very soon, the federal government and these veterans also, what they have observed that these institutions are not following the proper standards of higher education. They are providing the low quality education and which is wasting the public money because the taxpayers' money. So this is the history, and now this federal government started giving accreditation to the universities, and it was made mandatory that these war veterans will get, those war veterans will be given financial assistance which will take admission into these accredited universities, etc. So this is the history from where this accreditation process has started. There are various international agencies I am just people from our, you know that from India, in a large number of persons in library science and in BTech for BTech courses, for master's courses they go to. And so generally I have heard from my some of my colleagues that I am going to Canada, I am going to America, but I will take admission in the program which will be ALA, American Libraries Association accredited. Because until and unless that program will not be accredited by the American Library Association, then that will not help me in getting the job. So because in US, in developed countries, this accreditation process was started very early. Just as I was discussing about the history of this accreditation in 1880s and then after World War II. So this is a long history. But what are the international networks? International Network for Quality Assurance Agencies in Higher Education is a global association of quality assurance organizations, both governmental and non-government. It was founded in 1991 with 8 member organizations and now has 280. What is the scenario in the United States? Because basically in the United States, this accreditation process is basically taken by the private agencies, like professional bodies, like in India also, we can our ILA, like our ISLE. These bodies can take this type of responsibility of accreditation programs. When we have large number of universities, we have large number of colleges in India in up to 1990s, but accreditation of all these programs, because we don't have such an infrastructure, so it is not possible that we start immediately this accreditation programs in India. So what was the first step which was taken by the UGC towards this quality assurance of higher education was this implementation of national eligibility test. This was the first step that government of India has taken. You all know what is national eligibility test, because there were large number of universities and UGC and our higher bodies were observing that the master level outcome is not up to a standard that can go for teaching in the colleges, in the universities. So what they have implemented in 1989, they have implemented that they have come with the concept of NET, that any person who will go into the higher education system that should have clear NET, that should have NET as the qualification. What was the drawback of this NET? There was also a drawback of this NET. I will say that I have done my master's in 1998. I have cleared my NET immediately in 1998. But this NET has drawback also, because when this NET was implemented, there was no, the higher education standard was very, very low. Not much students can clear this, couldn't clear this NET examination. And the candidates, the students, which the postgraduate students who clear this NET examination, they will get the job immediately. And जो उनका research aptitude bind था, जो students का वो खत्म हो जाता था. जिन students ने research कर करके बहुत higher जाना था, क्योंकि job मिल जाती है जब आदमी को, job एक बहुत बड़ी satisfaction होती है. तो इसका सबसे बड़ा नुकसान क्या हुआ NET का, इससे जब ये शुरू में इम्प्लीमेंट हुआ तो इससे क्या हुआ कि लोगों को जॉब बड़ी इजीली मिल जाती थी नेट क्लियर कर करके, और जो उनका रिसर्च एप्टीट्यूड था वो वहां पर खत्म हो जाता था. ये इसका एक ड्रॉबैक भी था. सो वी आर हियर एंड देयर आर वेयर रीजनल एक्सटर्नल क्वालिटी नेटवर्क्स, दीज आर क्वालिटी, देयर इज वन यूरोपियन नेटवर्क फॉर क्वालिटी एश्योरेंस, एंड विद इन दिस यूरोपियन नेटवर्क फॉर क्वालिटी एश्योरेंस देयर इज क्वालिटी एश्योरेंस ऑफ क्रॉस बॉर्डर. This is some screen problem. This is QACHE is part of the European Network for Quality Assurance, ARB Network of Quality Assurance in Higher Education, Asia Pacific Quality Network. EQE networks helps in, but what are the purpose of these external quality networks, these regional levels, these international networks? Because they are for promotion of curriculum coherence, improvement in teaching learning processes, and enhancement of learning outcomes. This, because when they coordinate with each other, they can share their thoughts, they share their ideas, how we can bring these concepts of higher education into their nations. So we have just discussed this UGC concept. We have discussed this. There are various bodies like All India. This we have also discussed. And now the process of establishment of national assessment and accreditation. Basically, this accreditation process in India started in 1994 with the establishment of National Assessment and Accreditation Council. And in 1994, another body was also established, that is National Board of Accreditation. And with this higher education institution, because these are external quality, up to the time up, we have discussed various international quality networks. We have discussed various continental level. We are these are external quality networks, but to give various inputs to these national international networks, there is one step is very mandatory, that we have internal quality assurance cells in our institutions. And this process also started at IKVC, because NAC has made mandatory that every higher education institution should have an IKVC. And now what happened? आप सबको पता ही है, जैसे कि चूंकि हमारा ये सेवंथ पे एडमिशन था, इसमें सिक्स पे एडमिशन जो हमारा आया था, इसके अंदर क्या हुआ था? क्वांटिफिकेशन, यू शुड हैव एपीआई, एकेडमिक परफॉर्मेंस इंडिकेशंस. ओवरनाइट मेनी जर्नल्स स्टार्टेड, ऑनलाइन जर्नल्स, यू कैन पब्लिश देम, यू कैन लोट ऑफ आर्टिकल्स. एंड वट हैज स्टार्टेड, मैसिफिकेशन ऑफ दिस जर्नल्स हैज स्टार्टेड, एंड द क्वालिटी बिकम all kind of plagiarism and all kind of things, these become very common, and you can publish them articles, you can pay the money, overnight you can publish 10 articles, and there is no quality and there is no meaning of this, because UGC has started calculating the promotion criteria on the basis of quantitative approach. So when they studied the drawback of this system, then they bring some improvement in various amendments, and now this new amendments which were released on 18 July 2018, they are just similar to before the amendment, regulations which were before 2006. They are mostly based on the quality system, that you should have one good publication, then with the two good publications you can get the promotions. And even for librarians also, the more stress is on their professional work rather than for the publications and doing training and doing some courses, etc., for the progress of their library. These are the various initiatives, and this is how National Assessment and Accreditation Council, it was started in 1994, and the mandate of NAC as reflected in its vision statement is in making quality assurance an integral part of the functioning of higher education institutions. This is what kind of institutions they give accreditation. They give accreditation to autonomous colleges, they give accreditation to colleges, they give accreditation to the universities. And what is their criteria? What is their criteria? Curricular aspects has 150 marks for the universities, 150 for the autonomous colleges, and 100 for the affiliated undergraduate colleges, 100 for the, these are the criteria, teaching, learning and evaluation, 200 for the universities. You can see this criteria. This is also lying on the NAC website. This is the, these are six curricular aspects: teaching, learning and evaluation, research, innovation and extension, infrastructure, and our library will come under this. Infrastructure and learning resources, student sport and progression, governance, leadership and management, institutional values and best practices. And this is the criteria for the NAC. Now, as per the guidelines, all the higher education institution need to submit AQAR, annual quality assurance report, online. Submitting AQAR by, you have to, it is from the 1st January 2019, NAC has made it mandatory that you have to submit your AQAR only through online mode. You can't send it by email or through by post. You have to register yourself on the portal, and then only you can submit the, because your AQR. After submission of AQR, it will be verified by the NEC and clarification may be asked regarding the data information provided in the AQR. During the clarification period, the higher education institution can edit their AQR based on the clarification requested and resubmit the AQR within specified 15 days time is given that if there is some clarification, they can resubmit. After verification of the response submitted by higher education institution, the AQR will be accepted. So, if any institution want to go for reassessment, that can go after reassessment after only after 5 years, they have to submit 4 AQRs. But what is, because there is a lot of pressure on the NEC for this accreditation. So to the institutions which are A grade, they sometimes extend their accreditation for further 4 to 2 years. Like Punjab University was accredited by NEC in 2015 for 5 years up to 2020, but they have given extension up to 2022 because till date, not all the universities even, there are many universities which have not gone for accreditation even for once. So I can share with you the summary of how many institutions have gone for NEC accreditation till date. They are in the separate file and how many are reassessed. So this is the process, and the institutions which will go for reaccreditation after 7 years, they have to submit the 6 AQR annual quality assurance reports. These all AQR, they are all maintained by the internal quality assurance cells. How this bibliometric data validation methodology of NEC, which we submit various research papers. This is our research output of our university, how they validate this process is done by the InfoLibNet with the help of three databases. You are, Web of Science is a very huge database. Generally, we think that this Web of Science is a science citation index. It is not science citation index, it is science citation index. It is social science citation index, arts and humanities citation index, conference proceeding citation index, conference proceeding citation index, social sciences and humanities. These are all inbuilt into this Web of Science. This cumulation of this is Web of Science. And another is Scopus, and another is Indian citation index. This is for Indian publication by one private vendor, Diva Enterprises. And we are discussing Web of Science, Clarivate Analytics, published by number of journals index, 14,198. You can see the list from this website, Scopus Elsevier. This amount of, you can see, you can click on the link and you can now, because this is an old data on the NEC website, it is now nearly 41,000 this time. And Indian Citation Index, this is Diva Enterprises, 1330. Now, because India is very curious in this quality, now they have reduced this 1331 is now only 1200, because they have also now very quality conscious and they have reduced the number of journals in their Indian citation in their publication. And this is the ranking, how the institutions get the grade. 3.514 is A++, 3.262, this is A+, this is the 3.01, these are the various criteria. And if the grade is less than 1.50, this is just like fail, which we generally said that the institution has failed. This is not accredited. So this is the NEC, this is the accreditation history of PU. PU was accredited by NEC in 2001 for the first cycle, in 2009 for the second cycle, and in 2015 for the third cycle. So I have just discussed these details with you. This is 3.35 latest ranking, latest CGP of Punjab University, A+, A grade. We have talked about this NEC. NEC goes for the institution accreditation. But what is the difference between NEC and NBA? There is another body, NBA, National Board of Accreditation. First of all, the difference is this only looks after the technical institution. This is the major difference. And another major difference is this doesn't go for the institutional accreditation, it only goes for the program accreditation. If an institution is running sports 20 program, there are chances that 10 programs may be accredited and be accredited, and there are 10 programs are not NBA accredited, because they, if the program by after having worked the structure, इसमें ऐसा है जैसे कि आप suppose an institution is running 20 programs, वो सिर्फ 10, उसको लगता है कि हमारे 10 program का इतना level है कि हम उनको accredit करा सकते हैं, तो 10 की accreditation कराते हैं, और क्या होता है कि बल्कि 20 try और उसमें से सिर्फ 10 हुए, तो सिर्फ 10 accredited हो गए और 10 नहीं हुए. और उसमें जो NBA का accreditation में है, जैसे कि मैं अभी जैसे NBA की वेबसाइट देख रहा था कि हमारा फार्मेसी डिपार्टमेंट, अभी भी हमने जो ये लेटेस्ट हमारी 2020 की जो जून में अभी वो हुई है NIRF की रैंकिंग, उसमें वो सेकंड रैंक पे आया है हमारा फार्मेसी डिपार्टमेंट, परंतु वो NBA accredited नहीं है. क्योंकि कई बार इंस्टीट्यूशन ये सोचती है कि हमारा इतना बड़ा लेवल है कि हमें इस accreditation की अभी जरूरत नहीं है, हमें इतना इस पे रिसोर्स मोबिलाइजेशन करने की जरूरत नहीं है, ये तो हम क्लियर कर ही लेंगे. ये भी एक क्राइटेरिया है कि कुछ लोगों का जो NBA accreditation नहीं है. परंतु सबसे बड़ा जो इसका फायदा है, इसका क्या है कि जैसे कि आप कंपनीज को इनवाइट करते हैं, तो वो ये कुछ कंपनीज ऐसा देखती हैं कि मतलब कि जो जो प्रोग्राम है वो आपका accredited है या नहीं है. मान लीजिए सपोज योर प्रोग्राम इज नॉट NBA accredited, देन दे डोंट गो फॉर प्लेसमेंट इन दैट फॉर in that institution under the program. So what are the NBA credit the program on the basis of objectives, organization and governance, infrastructure facilities, quality of teaching and learning, curriculum design and review, sports services and any other aspect as decided by the general council or executive committee of NBA, which will help the graduates produced by the institution as per the industry requirement. So this is the detail of the our one we have University Institute of Engineering and Technology, how many programs are accredited, how many programs are accredited up to 2020. One program is this UIT Biotechnology, this was accredited for 2 years, now this program is not accredited, you can see. So this is only these programs of Punjab University, although Punjab University has MBA college and that is also a well reputed college, a pharmacy college, which comes under the program accreditation of this NBA, but they are not accredited because I don't know, the departments have not taken the interest what is the criteria, but only these programs of Punjab University are accredited by the NBA. What is the structure of this internal quality assurance cells? We have also discussed that we have external quality assurance networks, and these are what are the purpose of this internal quality assurance. This AQAM, we are submission of it, jaise ki hum पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी का केस करूं, आज मैं सुबह ही बात कर रहा था कि हमने पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी ने क्या है, इंटरनल क्वालिटी एश्योरेंस सेल ने सॉफ्टवेयर डेवलप किया है. उस सॉफ्टवेयर में क्या है कि उसमें एक पोर्टल बनाई हुई है जिसका पासवर्ड, उसमें हर एक इंस्टीट्यूशन को पर्सनलाइज लॉगिन दिया हुआ है. उसमें वो क्या है, टाइम टू टाइम अपनी इंफॉर्मेशन फीड करते रहते हैं, और वो जो फीड है वो सेंट्रल पोर्टल में जाकर के सेव होती है, और उससे क्या है वो उससे हमारी जो हमें नेक के लिए क्या वेयर बनानी होती है वो उसमें वो इजी प्रोसेस हो जाता है इससे. तो ये सारा का सारा क्या है कि ये इंटरनल क्वालिटी एश्योरेंस सेल ये सारा साल काम करती रहती है, जो जिसकी वजह से हम आफ्टर 5 years और 4 years, आफ्टर 6 years और 4 years वी कैन सबमिट आवर SSR, वो हमें सेल्फ रिपोर्ट सबमिट करनी होती है जिसको SSR कहते हैं, जिसके बेस पर वो फिर द्वारा हमें रीअसेस करते हैं. तो दिस इज द जनरल व्हाट इज द प्रोसेस ऑफ दिस इंटर, what are the duties of this internal quality assurance cells. Institutional accreditation has been, so ye ek study, ye hai center for policy research in higher education, ye NIPA ke andar ek body hai, unhone case study ki hai ki IQAM se jo Mohanlal Sukhadia university hai, unhone kya hai uske andar bade positive changes aaye hain. There is lot of improvement in infrastructure and physical facility as well as in implementation of changes as advised by peer review teams. Till date, where are the lacunas? Till date, there is no effective measures to assess the improvements in programs being offered, pedagogical practices and classroom processes through EQA and IQA. These are still not. We don't have any guarantee that there is any improvement here has been seen in these areas. What is this? NIRF? Sir, I am seeing a lot of disturbance because this the candidates which are joining us again and again, the C waiting room is appearing here on the screen.
Sir, you just avoid that. I'm admitting all the participants. So you just
are admitting,
avoid
but it is again and again appearing on the screen, na?
Oh, okay, okay, okay.
It is again and again appearing on the screen, which is
causing okay. Problem. Okay, I'll just take care, sir. Thank you.
Where the countries which are ranking of higher education institution, from where this ranking of higher education institutions was started, the ranking system of university started with publication of academic ranking of all universities in 2003. First ranking system was developed in this 2003 by the academic ranking of all universities. This was followed by time higher education ranking from 2004 onwards, based on the data collected and analyzed by Quacquarelli Simmons. In 2010, the Times Higher Education Ranking and this Cavus ranking split, and each of them started releasing separate rankings. Beyond these three major ranking systems, there were other governments like Center for World University Ranking in 2012, Moscow International University Ranking in 2017. All these rankings are based on weightage to teaching, research, reputation, etc. Basically, why we have established NIRF in India? Because our higher education institutions are not falling in any of these ranking in time higher education ranking, and many other developed countries in higher education institutions are not falling in these rankings. So they have started their national institutional ranking framework so that they can improve their higher education system and they can then compete globally with these global ranking systems. NIRF ranks universities and colleges, technical institutions, management institutions and pharmacy institutions separately. There is, well, you have seen many of you, because this is a very recent phenomenon. In June, NIRF released their ranking. They have one overall ranking and they have separate ranking for colleges, technical institutions, management institutions and pharmacy institutions. They have for different types of dental institutions and medical institutions. And they give rank on the basis of this five criteria: research and professional practices, teaching, learning and resources, graduation outcomes, outreach and inclusivity, and perception. What is the public perception about the institution? The parameters are same for all types of institution, but weightage depend on focus of their engagement. NIRF intends to address the issue of improving the status of Indian institutions in the global ranking. India has already declared 20 institutions of eminence, 10 public sector institutions and 10 private. You all know that Delhi University, Banaras Hindu University, these are declared as institutions of eminence, and some private select, say another university, and JP, like many other universities are. Also, public sector universities are also declared as the. What is the purpose of this declaring this institution of eminence? Because somehow we can make place in the top 100 institutions at the global level. This is because they have identified these are the institutions with some capacity building. They can improve themselves and ultimately can make our position into the global ranking system. And this is the Indian ranking. This is just one slide. And Indian ranking, you have Indian Institute of Technology. This is overall ranking of all the institution. Institute of ranking, IIT Madras was ranked first. Indian Institute of Science, you can see these are all available on the NIRF website. This is history of Punjab University ranking, first among universities of India and 38th in Asia. Times Higher Education Asian University ranking 2015, ranked the number one university in India and in the bracket of 276 to 300. None of the Indian universities till date has appeared in the top 100 institutions in the global ranking. We are very happy when the Punjab University was ranked one somewhere but around 2014. And it was in the bracket of 276 to 300 international. So our purpose, our aim of this quality assurance in higher education of these all bodies, NAAC and PA, that we can globally compete with the higher education system of the world. ranked 39th by Time Magazine amongst BRICS and emerging economies, ranked 44th in NIRF 2020 among overall institutions. This is the literature. Punjab University is ranked 44th in NIRF. Now we come to the quality in journal publications. You all know impact factor is one of the important criteria. Generally, if we talk about the quality of a journal, we talk about the what is the impact factor of the journal. How you all know what is the impact factor? It is a very common thing now. However, we see our only impact factor is not the only criteria, because not all citation reflect good research. Authors in the same network tend to cite each other heavily. English speaking countries are favored since these countries host citation analysis. This is a kind of biasness, because the most of these databases are from the developed countries and from the English countries. So there is some kind of some favoritism is also there. The type of article inferences, review articles tend to get more citation than original research articles. Peer analysis. The second factor is whether the journal is peer reviewed or not peer reviewed, and if it is peer reviewed, what kind of panel of experts is of peer of the present experts of that journal. Circulation and coverage, what is the coverage of the, that is whether the journal is reaching to the international audience or not, or whether the journal is an online forum or not. So these are all the criteria which comprises the quality of a journal. And beside these, there are other criteria, standardized research reporting framework, a standard set by the journal that ensures that all the information you need to assess the research in a paper is present. Journal ranking, this is based on the citation record as well as the prestige of the journal. It gives the perception of the journal by a researcher. Discussion whether the journal has discussion platform, acceptance rejection dates, these are the other criteria. Journal citation report, how we calculate this journal impact factor. Journal impact factor, you all know, is calculated on the basis of journal citation report. How we calculate the impact factor? If we have to calculate the impact factor of 2020 of a particular journal A, what we will see, what are the total number of citation of that journal A in the last 2 years, that is in 2018 and 2018, and divided by the total number of citable items. So this is calculated because this JCR was 12. You all know that science citation, this is a part of science citation index, and this all concept is developed by the Eugene Garfield of Philadelphia University. And this JCR 2019 includes 11,896 index journals, and only in these 11,896 journals the citation of that particular journal is seen for calculating the impact factor, covering 236 disciplines, 81 countries and regions, and 2.3 million articles, reviews, and other source items. In comparison to how Scopus becomes so familiar, so much popular these days, because the coverage is much higher. There is only 11,896 index journals, and in this there are 41317. If you go to the Scopus website and you will click the sources, how many sources are indexed? 41317. These are journals, conference proceedings, various book series, and various trade reports, etc. And total number of constitutes the 41,370 results. And if you will see the top 10% of it, if you have to see how I have to publish, I am doing a very high quality research, how I will select my, in which journal I will select for my publication, then you can take the help of this source, that what are the journals in the top 10%, what are the first quarter. They have also made the first quartile, second quartile, third quartile, and fourth quartile. And 10 won't show only titles in top 10%. These are 3283 results appeared. If we click on the show only, that is in top 10%. If we will show, we will click on the first quartile book series. We want to see only first quartile. We want to publish in a book series and we want to choose a book series. Then you have to, and we will click on the first quartile book series. And this is the first quartile book series, 85 results will appear. If you will see what are the first quartile conference proceedings, 19 results will appear. If you will see what are the various trade publications, which are of very high standards, these are the 803 trade publications which are covered in the scope of data. This is your UGC care list. Today, what UGC for getting promotion, for getting an appointment in a university or a college, the selection committee or the promotion committee considers only Scopus index, Web of Science index, which is generally called SCI index, and UGC care list journals. And this UGC care list, UGC has created one consortium of which headquarters lies in the University of Pune, which brings out this UGC care list. And I have selected the chemistry journals. There are 35 journals of chemistry which are in the UGC care list. You can also select in the library science of your discipline, which are the journals in the UGC care list. And publishing beyond these journals, which are not Scopus index, which are not Web of Science index, or which are not in the UGC care list, there is no meaning of any accountability of your research for getting promotion, etc., getting an appointment. This is Indian Citation Index. When I go to the analyzer of this Indian Citation Index, institutional analyzer, what I have observed, it's, if you will see the trend in this graph, the trend goes higher and higher from 2008, higher in 2009, higher in 2012-13, higher, then slightly down, then higher, and then higher, because this is the period when this API started appearing. This API system was, and the person started, if the person is interested or not interested, they started publishing in the journals, and the number of publications started appearing in the different journals, whether they are good quality, whether they are of bad quality, and you will see the sharp decline in the 2019, because the UGC has come out with a different criteria in 2018, and that was not so much fussy about this number of publications, and that was more concentrated. The more stress was on the quality rather than on the quantity. And one more thing, because I have done my PhD thesis on the agriculture scientist, and while doing some literature survey, but there is one observation that the agriculture research is generally seen in the indigenous journals. So this is an Indian Citation Index. This only covers the Indian journals. You will see, if you will see the top 50 institutions, Indian Agriculture Research Institute, mostly Punjab Agriculture University, and this Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, many in the 50 top institutions, many are the agriculture research institutes, because in agriculture there is a lot of weightage to the, because most of the problems, they are of local relevance in agriculture, and they are generally published in the Indian journals. So this I also observe one trend here. And another, this is another very, very high quality database that is also from the Elsevier, that is called as SciWeb. But you will observe here, India is on the fifth rank in the amount of publications. And when we will see its citation impact, although there are 15 institutions, but I was taking the screenshot from somewhere. So if you will see also in these 13 institutes, it is on the 12th rank. Otherwise, it is on the in the 15th institution, it was on the 14th rank. If you will see in this screen, it is on the 13th rank. Only one institution is behind this. Russian Federation is behind this India. Other, if you will see the number of publications, it is on the 5th rank. It means we have quantity, but we don't have the quality. This is very much clear from this slide, which is taken from this Scopus database, taking data from 2014 to 2019. This is again depicted in this slide. The number of publications are on the 5th number, and again we will see the citations per publication. They are again on the. If you will see in this 13th, only one institution is lesser than this 3.8. This Russian Federation is lesser than this India. So we have quantity. We have massive productivity. We have massification of higher education. We have high number of publications, but ultimately we have low citation impact. So we have the need of the hour is to improve the quality of our higher education system, to improve the quality of our research. This is also one product. It is on the similar line that Scopus has their high-end product SciWeb, and the JCR or this Web of Science have their high-end product that is called as Insight. So from this product, you can also generate various kinds of high-level metrics about your institution. You can about your research performance, benchmark to other institutions, help in strategic decision-making, cost-benefit analysis of your research program, promote internal and external partnership and collaborations, identify experts both inside and out. These are similar products. One product is from Scopus side, another product is from Web of Science. This is they are high-end products because I have seen these products because of my posting in Punjab University of Institution. So these Caribbean persons and these Algebra persons, they sometimes visit, they show their products. These are the various metrics you can have from these products. So this is all about my presentation about the quality assurance of higher education system in India. Thank you. Over to.
Thank you, Dr. Sir. I just request to you ki please shut down your screen sharing. Yeah, thank you, sir. So I just call the question answer from chat box. So 2 persons are responding, and the both the question is very valid. First of all, Manoj Kumar Sinha from NEHU, you must know Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha. He asking how to improve NIRF ranking.
Yeah. NIRF ranking, you can see the criteria. They evaluate your institution on the basis of 5 criteria, which I have shown in my slides. So by improving on these 5 criteria on research impact, teaching learning, you can improve your ranking in the NIRF. You have to work. You have worked with the quality, total quality management approach. You have to work into all these areas. Then you can improve your NIRF ranking.
Okay. Thank you. I hope Sinha ji got his answer. And another question is from Dr. Sanjeev Kumar from Varanasi. He is asking what is the role of AISHE? In NAC accreditation,
All India Survey of Higher Education. This is a government body. This gross enrollment ratio. This is a body which does various kind of surveys for the higher education system and which provide various statistics. So I was talking about the gross enrollment ratio earlier. That is, it is in 26.3 in 2018-19, and it is going to be 30% in 2020. It was 25. These are all the findings they are produced by the All India Survey on Higher Education. And this is a supporting body of this NAC. I also have seen this there are various responsibilities of the NAC that are done by this All India Survey of Higher.
Okay, Thank you very much, sir. And the chat box is open. So if you find any question relevant to your presentation, then you can answer from there. Otherwise, I hope everything is you can take care and cover very well. So I do have Lalita ji with us now. So I just hand over to Lalita ji. If she is not present, then I request Salek ji to give the word of thanks. So Lalita ji, are you there?
Anji sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I am very much there. And thanks to Dr. Jivesh. It was a wonderful session. And my participants also liked it. And they have said that it is very informative, intellectual.
Although I have I am interrupting you. Basically, I have to make some presentation. I was invited as a panelist by this Web of Science. I go through some document of the Center for Policy Research in Higher Education of this NIPA. From there, I have developed, after going through this document, I have worked this area. So I have seen some interest into this area. Then recently, I was invited by this ILA for some talk. Then I have done some more study. Now, Malivaji called me. Then I did some more study. So this is adding more and more to my profile that I am studying more and more, because for delivering lecture here, I have done some more hard work by going this cyber, by studying this insight, scope of sources, what are these first quartile journals, second quartile journals. Now you can, if you are managing the profile, if you are working in periodical section, and you have to manage a large profile of journals, which journal to be selected and which journal not to be selected. You are a director in IIT, you have to select some person who can significantly improve the research impact of that higher education institution. These databases, the SciWell, these insight-like products, these Scopus-like products, they also help there, that how many citations are there, how many citations are in first quartile journals, how many papers are in second quartile. These are all the things which help in this making a an academic professional network.
Rightly said, sir. PJ have also subscribed Web of Science and Scopus database. So we should concentrate on the citations part also. And the impact factor of the journal is also important. So sir, I hope that everyone has been motivated and encouraged to go through all those things which you have told and will inculcate in our institutes for the research purpose. And we can improve our national ranking of the institute. Thank you, sir. Words are less to express gratitude for you and especially for the participants who have spared their valuable time. And we are hopeful that we will meet again soon. And now I invite Dr. Salek Chand, for President, Secretary of this association, to say a few words, formal vote of thanks. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. And really, I don't have any words to express my really feelings about this lecture and presentation. Really, Dr. Jivesh Bansal, actually, the presentation was very excellent. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
First of all, Dr. Saab, actually, I have seen first time you. And I congratulate for this presentation as well as a librarian of the worldwide university, that is Punjab University. Really, I like
thank
you.
Thank you, sir.
I like, really.
I thank really you, sir. Care. Thank you, sir. Because this COVID-19 situation, I was also busy in some library services.
Yeah.
I can't give much time to this. So next time we will prepare more much time and we will give much time to my presentation.
But during this hard period, we got an opportunity to hear your wordings and explanation about the higher education and other allied area. Really, it was very nice, sir. And thanks to Lalita ji as a coordinator, moderator, LPA coordinator, Punjab and Chandigarh, and thanks to our hosting team, especially Anand ji and other team members. And lastly, my big thanks goes to my lovely beloved participant really for their regular contribution to the LPA. Thank you. Thanks to all of you, and Dr. Jives, thank you very much once again. Thanks to all of you. Thank you very much. Okay, Anand.
I do have one or two submission. We do have another webinar on 27th, and after that we have the 4th July. Dr. Neeraj and Santhil Kumar on 27th. So I request all the participants, you get the message through the WhatsApp group, through the mail. So you have to register for the webinar. So as usually I mentioned everywhere, okay, this webinar is free for all, but only who needed the certificate, they just pay rupees 50 for the contribution of the generation of the certificate and all. So thank you so very much. And very soon I'm sending the next webinar information to all of you. Thank you very much.